Hello students, today we will discuss the topic testing of materials. Testing of materials is mainly intended for maintaining the quality of final product. The purpose of these tests are to find various mechanical properties, and at the same time we can detect surface and internal defects also. We are going to cover destructive tests like tensile test, compression test, shear test, creep test and fatigue test. Students, various non-destructive tests that we cover in this chapter are radiography test, ultrasonic test, magnetic test, etc. The main objective of this topic is to know the detailed testing procedures adopted for conducting the tests. The next one is compression test. This is just a reversal of the tensile test. So in the compression test, the reverse the direction of forces used in the tension test. In this test, the stress increases rapidly near the end of the test due to an increase in area of the specimen. The specimen selected depends upon the metal being tested. Generally, the compression test is developed on the materials like wood and brick, etc. So the stress strain diagram for compression for different materials like cast iron and steel. So in this case, there is no yield point and there is no proportional limit. Directly the material comes to the fracture state. Suddenly that fracture is also sudden one in the case of cast iron and in the case of steel. So these are the graphs obtained between the stress and strain when it is subjected to compressive load. The next one is shear test. In this test, the force required per unit area to produce fracture when impressed vertically upon the cross section of a material. There are the two types of shear, that is single shear and double shear. Shear strength may be calculated by the amount of force needed to make the shear over a given cross sectional area. Shear strength is equals to applied load by area in shear. In a double shear, the force and the area are doubled, resulting the same shear strength. The area of the shear, which is the shear strength and area of the shear, will be expressed in the following figures. So the first figure shows the single shear, where the workpiece specimen is fixed between the two jaws and the load is applied, as shown in the figure, by maintaining a small clearance, and the corresponding shear area will be calculated. Whereas in the case of double shear, that is the workpiece is fixed between the two spaces shown in the figure and the load is applied. So in both these cases, single shear and double shear, the amount of shear stress and shear strain is calculated and the corresponding graph we are developing. The next one is hardness test. Hardness is usually defined as the resistance to indentation. The most common method of measuring the hardness metals is by determining the resistance offered to the indentation. The three most important hardness tests are Brinell hardness test, Rockwell hardness test and Vickers hardness test. First one is Brinell hardness test. So in the case of Brinell hardness test, we are using ball indenter and the experimental setup as shown in the figure. So in this case, the experimental setup, the workpiece is placed in the vise and the handle we are using for downloading. And here we are using the ball indenter for the case of Brinell test and the diamond indenter for the case of a Vickers test. So in the case of a Brinell hardness test, it consists of indenting the surface of the metal by hardened steel ball under load. So the height of the specimen can be raised by hand wheel so that the specimen is brought into contact with the indenter, which is forced into the specimen by the specified load. So generally the Brinell hardness number, which explains the amount of hardness in terms of numbers. So the Brinell hardness number is calculated by using the equation BHN is equals to P by A or P by pi d by 2 into d minus root of d square capital D square minus small d square, where P is equals to load applied in kgs, capital D is equal to diameter of ball in mm, small d is equals diameter of impression in mm and capital A is equal surface area of indentation in mm square. This that the table shows the different loads for different materials with the 10 mm indenter or ball indenter we are using. So the brindle hardness test, now we are using 10 mm balls and different loads we are applying. That is, for the case of steel, that is maximum load we can apply is 3000 kgs. In the case of copper, it is 1000, and in the case of aluminium, it is 500. That means depending upon the material properties, the load applied is also different. And then Rockwell test. In this test, the hardness is determined by the depth of indenter rather by surface area of indentation. In the Rockwell test, uses either a steel ball for softer materials. Rockwell testing machine is as shown in the figure 1 in the previous figure. It has a dial with different scales to read hardness number directly. Whereas in the case of brindle hardness number, we will calculate the number by using some formulas. Whereas in the Rockwell hardness test, we will given that value directly from the scales. A further load called major load, 90 kgs for soft materials and 140 kg for hard materials. In this case, there are the two loads, minor load and major loads are applied on a particular specimen, and we will find the depth of penetration of the indenter relative to the zero position. It is recorded in the suitable dial gauge. So this figure shows the Rockwell hardness testing. So in this case of the workpiece is placed, this is a specimen, it is placed in the vise which is open. On the top surface of the specimen, it is prepared with and applied chalk powder on it, and the workpiece, the vise is moving vertically upwards such that it can touches the indenter. So here we are using the indenter as steel ball for soft materials and diamond cone for hard materials. This one is the direct reading scale, where the reading we can calculate directly after application of the load, either in the form of steel ball or in the form of diamond cone. So in this figure, in the case of brindle hardness method, we are calculating that hardness value by using the formula BHN is equals to P by A. Whereas in this case, we are calculating the value directly from the scale. So in this one is the included angle for the case of a diamond indenter, that is 120 degrees, where P is the minor load in kgs, capital P is major load in kgs when we are applying. So in this case, initially minor load is applied and the next one is major load is applied, and we will calculate how much depth of penetration, so that is small d. Vickers hardness test. This is another test for calculation of the hardness. This test is conducted on machines with an indenter of a square based diamond pyramid having an angle of 136 degrees as shown in this figure. So here there is the included angle 136 degrees, and this is a square based diamond pyramid we are using in the Vickers testing. This is the Vickers equipment testing. Here we are fixing the square based diamond pyramid, and that handle is used to lower this one, and the workpiece is also moving upwards and such that it can touches the pyramid. And then we are applying the load. The applied load is selected according to the thickness of the hardness of the specimen. That means for thin sections the load is different, for thick sections the load is different. Similarly, the load is also selected depending upon the type of material we are going to test, whether it is a soft material or hard material. So that one is also considered as one of the factor for calculation of the Vickers hardness. The next test is impact test. The behavior of materials under dynamic loading may sometimes differ markedly from their behavior under static loading or gradually increasing loads. So generally, in the case of gradually applied load, we are using gradually applied load from 0 to some maximum value. Whereas in the suddenly applied load, the same load is applied suddenly. Whereas in the impact load, the load is dropped from some height. That is, the same load is dropped from some height. That means the intensity of that load depends upon the height from which it is dropped. So if it is dropped from 5 meters, the effect is somewhat different. If it is dropped from 10 meters, the effect is different, increased, such that the height from which the load is dropped is the main criteria in the case of impact test. There are the two types of impact test. The first one is Charpy test and the second one is ISO test. This is the experimental setup of Charpy machine. So this experimental setup consists of an anvil and a metal body and the pendulum, the pointer, this is the pointer and this is the scale. So the scale represents the movement of the pendulum in this direction. The pendulum is fixed at some height and the workpiece is placed simply supported between the two supports. Whenever this pendulum strikes the workpiece, if the workpiece will be breaked and the pendulum will be forwarded to some distance, and that forwarded distance will be collected by making the pointer will be moved. So that pointer reading will also be considered for calculation of the impact test. In the case of Charpy test, the workpiece is fixed as shown in the figure like a simply supported beam, whereas in the case of ISO test, the workpiece is fixed in the form of a cantilever beam. Whereas in this case, its striking edge is applied like this, and in the opposite direction, in a notch of 45 degrees angle will be developed for this purpose. So generally the sizes between that is clear span available is 40 mm and the total span is 55 for the checking purpose. The next test is ISOD machine. Similarly, in this case also the same base anvil specimen is fixed, that is vertically, whereas in the previous case it is fixed horizontally, and the handle will be fixed vertically upwards, that pendulum. Whenever the pendulum will be relieved, that strikes the workpiece which is on the notch portion, and the corresponding workpiece will be damaged, and it will be forwarded, and the pendulum will be forwarded to some value. So that forward motion will be appeared on the scale by pointer, and these two readings will be coming to picture. So this is the movement of this is the fixation of the ISOD specimen, where it is fixed, that is the distance from top to notch is 22 mm, and it is a striking edge will be applied at an angle of 10 degrees with the horizontal and 5 degrees with the vertical, such that it can damage the workpiece at the notched portion only. So this notch formation for all these Charpy test and ISO test, the notch is having an angle of 45 degrees only. The next one is fatigue test. So up to this stage we are discussing only the static loads, that is the metals or the workpieces will subjected to only one type of load. But in this case it will subjected to reversal stresses fail at that is under calculation of the ultimate strength. This phenomenon of fatigue is different when compared with others. Metal subjected to reversal stresses fail at stress which is much below the ultimate tensile strength of a metal. This phenomenon is called fatigue. The resistance to failure from fatigue is called endurance. The stress at which the specimen exhibits infinite life is called endurance limit or fatigue limit. Generally, the fatigue tests are used to determine the endurance limit of the metal. So in this case, the test specimen used is a cylindrical one and subjected to bending loads during the rotation. The experimental setup is as shown in the figure, where it is, this one is a revolution counter, motor, coupling, bearings, and this one is a test specimen. Whereas the test specimen is a cylindrical one, and here we are applying some load. The test specimen subjected to bending, at the same time rotation developed with the help of motor. So such type of continuous bending and rotation on the same workpiece can develop the simultaneous stress formations. It is named as a fatigue. So this figure shows between the stress and the N value, the SN value curve for a steel. The fatigue testing machine is as shown in the figure. At least 6 specimens of identical shape, size and composition are considered for finding the fatigue strength. The first specimen is tested at a stress which is equals to 0.6 times the ultimate tensile strength, and the number of cycles at which the failure occurs is determined. The second and subsequent specimens are tested at decreased stresses. The stress is varied by using different loads, and the number of cycles or revolutions till failure occurs is noted. For each load. The next one is creep test. In the creep test, the continuing deformation of material under constant stress below the elastic deformation is called creep. The creep is always an important factor in material selection for parts like IC engines, jet engines, high pressure boilers and steam turbines where high temperature and stresses are encountered. The creep tests are conducted to determine the limiting stress which produce less than the prescribed amount of deformation at a given temperature with a specified time. Broadly, in the creep test, the specimen subjected to high temperature and load simultaneously. So then we will study the phenomenon properties. So this is the experimental setup shown for conducting creep test. So in this case, the specimen is fixed. So this is the furnace for maintaining high temperatures, and this is the load we are applying. So such that the specimen subjected to loading and at the same time the temperature, high temperature. So in this case, the stress developed due to the load and the stress developed due to the temperature also considered. So this concept of creep will be between the creep and the time. Generally the time is a varying factor for finding the value of the creep. So initially, so the figure shows the graph between creep and time while conducting a creep test. So this is the primary creep zone where the load is dominating, whereas in the secondary creep, it where the temperature is dominating, where the change in temperature is the varying factor to increase the stress on the specimen. In the case of territory creep, where the load and the temperature will comes into picture and ultimately the workpiece will fail. So that what happens in the case of this one is explained in the form of a graph. So in this case, the instantaneous deformation is also appears. That means in the original deformation diagrams, the load, the graph starts from zero, whereas in this case the graph starts from at some height. So that is called as instantaneous deformation. That is mainly due to the application of the temperature and load itself. Till now we have discussed various destructive tests, and now let us move to non-destructive tests. Up to this stage we are discussing about destructive tests. That means creating somewhat different, that is damage or to the workpieces. But in the case of non-destructive test, we don't want to damage the workpiece, and we will just find the inner defects of the parts, such as cracks, blowholes, voids, etc. So in the case of non-destructive tests, there are the important one. At the same time, it is not an economical one for ordinary operators. Where in the case of non-destructive tests, we are using different types of resources, such as X-rays, ultrasonic sound waves, magnetic waves, next red dye methods and spark methods. These are the different methods. So the following are the types of non-destructive tests. The first one is radiography. Radiography means which is used X-rays and gamma rays. Next one is ultrasonic test. So in this case we are using ultrasonic waves. Magnetic test, it is used to determine the surface defects. Penetrate test, to detect the surface cracks. And the spark test, to study the composition of metals. Let us come to the first one is radiography test. In the radiography test, we are using the X-rays and gamma rays. The short wavelength of radiant energy is used for the inspection of internal defects of metals. This test is employed for welded products and castings. In the case of welded products and castings, some internal defects will be developed due to the formation of cavities or due to the formation of molten metal, blowholes. So such a blowholes and other cracks formation or calculation, it is difficult for by the destructive methods. So in that case, we will go for non-destructive methods, such as application of X-rays and gamma rays for finding the internal defects. So the X-rays or gamma rays are used for radiography testing. X-rays produce when electrons moving with high speed impact anode metal in X-ray tube, whereas gamma rays produced by the decomposition of radioactive material such as radium. These rays pass through the solid material and attack a photographic plate. X-ray method is more rapid and are better than gamma rays for detection of small defects in section less than about 50 mm thick. So the figure shows the X-ray radiography and gamma ray radiography. So in this case, this is the experimental shielded setup for the production of X-rays, where from the cathode the electron will be developed, and the electrons will be projected over the anode. over the anode and it is deflected in the form of a rays. And this deflected rays will be projected over the specimen and the corresponding image will be developed. In the corresponding image, whenever there is a crack, that will be formed as a shadow. And whenever it is a good one, it is formed as an open territory. Similarly, in the case of radioactive source, we are using some gamma rays directly applied on the specimen. Instead of using some target or deflected rays, these rays are directly projected over the specimen and we will collect the image. In this case also, the same shadows will be appeared. But when considered with X-rays and gamma rays, the gamma ray is the most costlier one. Ultrasonic test. Sound waves with frequency beyond the audible range, that is greater than 20 kilohertz, are called ultrasonic waves. So in the case of sound waves, there are the two types. The first one is infrasonics and the second one is ultrasonics. The infrasonics means the sound range is less than 20 hertz, and ultrasonic means the sound range is more than 20,000 hertz or 20 kilohertz. So such ultrasonic waves are used for different purposes like welding and other purposes. So here the ultrasonic waves are used for finding the internal defects. The ultrasonic test is widely used for locating minute internal flaws in the large forgings, routine inspection of locomotive axles and wheel pins of fatigue cracks. Magnetic test. It is used for the detection of surface defects in ferromagnetic substances. In this test, the component is first magnetized, then a fine iron dust is applied on the surface. The filing will collected at a crack or void, owing to the intense field. That means north and south poles will be formed at the discontinuity and the magnetized area will be formed. Such an arrangement of iron filing on the surface reveals the flaw. The major application of this test is used for finding the fatigue cracks and at regular intervals to avoid possible accident due to fracture. So this is also named as MagnaFlex inspection method. The next one is penetrance test. In this method, we are using the penetrant, that means red dye etchant method. And this is also named as red dye etchant method. So here we are using some red paint on the application. We are applying the red paint on the surface of the casting. The surface is covered with fluorescent liquid, that is red paint is a fluorescent liquid which penetrates into the flaws. Excess liquid is removed and the surface is cleaned. So after the cleaning of the surface is dusted to draw off liquid and reveal the crack, such a fluorescent material will be penetrates into the crack. Last one is spark test. So in this test, the workpiece is pressed against a rotating grinding wheel and the corresponding sparks will be observed. So depending upon the sparks developed, we will find which type of material, whether it is softer one or harder one. So this is generally a simple visual inspection method for finding the softer or harder material, and it is the cheapest one when compared with other non-destructive methods. Metals are tested in order to measure its mechanical and physical properties. There are the different methods. The first one is destructive method and the second one is non-destructive method. The destructive method, we will find the physical and the mechanical properties of materials. Whereas in the non-destructive method, we will find the internal defects of metals such as blowholes and cracks, etc. Mechanical tests may be classified by the method of static, dynamic and cyclic tests. The different methods available for laboratory testing are: first one is tensile test, compression test, shear test, hardness test, impact test, creep test and fatigue test. The figure explains this between the stress strain diagram while conducting tension test. There are the different points available for A, that is the proportional limit, B, lower yield point, C, upper yield point, that is D, ultimate point, and E, fracture point. So this tensile test will be conducted on different materials. So for the different materials, that is high carbon steel. This curve is for high carbon steel, and the next one is for medium carbon steel, low carbon steel, cast iron, and plastics. So depending upon the composition and the constituents present in the metal, the different curves will be obtained as shown in the stress strain diagram. Hooke's law states that the stress is proportional to strain within the elastic limit only. Elastic limit. It is the maximum stress at which the material regains its deformation of removing the load. Yield point. It is the minimum stress at which the specimen is deformed without a noticeable increase in load. Ultimate tensile strength. It is maximum stress that a material can withstand without fracture under tensile load. It is also named as maximum stress or tenacity. Percentage elongation. It is defined as the ratio of increase in length of the specimen after fracture to its initial gauge length. Percent reduction in area. It is defined as the ratio of reduction in area of the naked portion of the fractured specimen to the initial cross-sectional area. So in the compression test, the reverse direction of forces used in the tension test. In this test, the stress increases rapidly near the end of the test due to an increase in area of the specimen. The specimen selected depends upon the metal being tested. Generally, the compression test is developed on the materials like wood and brick, etc. So in this case, there is no yield point and there is no proportional limit. Directly the material comes to the fracture state. Suddenly that fracture is also sudden one in the case of cast iron and in the case of steel. So these are the graphs obtained between the stress and strain when it is subjected to compressive load. Shear test. In this test, the force required per unit area to produce fracture when impressed vertically upon the cross section of a material. Hardness is usually defined as the resistance to indentation. Three most important hardness tests are Brinell hardness test, Rockwell hardness test and Vickers hardness test. The continuing deformation of material under constant stress below the elastic deformation is called creep. The types of non-destructive tests. The first one is radiography. Radiography means it is used X-rays and gamma rays. Next one is ultrasonic test. So in this case we are using ultrasonic waves. Magnetic test. It is used to determine the surface defects. Penetrate test to detect the surface cracks. And spark test to study the composition of metals. So far we have covered different types of tests performed on workpiece for studying the properties. Students, let us meet in the next session. Thank you. Goodbye.
Further clarification, contact the Additional Secretary, State Board of Technical Education and Training, 7th floor, BRKR Bhavan, Tank Bund Road, Hyderabad, 500063, fax 040-322-0546.